later we talk about crossing rates and the relationship with the crossing rate field with the other field of physics. And there's a lot of connection between the one physics to the other. And actually, you can almost assume that every physics is connected in some way. But I just picked these two things up because it looks kind of interesting to me. And then there's ongoing experiment which we share quite a lot of information between crossing rays and this field of physics. So that was dark matter and neutrino physics. And dark matter, which is nice photograph, is showing the distribution of dark matter. And it's 23% of energy and mass of the universe. So all the matter that we know is only 4% of the budget in the universe. And 23% is dark matter, and 70-some percent is dark energy. So it's quite a lot of percentage in our universe, and like six times larger than all the matter that we know about. But we still don't know exactly what they are, and what is their energy, and what is their property in general. But we do have lots of evidence about them. We do know that we need something massive, and something which does not emit any kind of light, so we can like really see them in any kind of electromagnetic radiation. But we need those kind of massive material in our galaxy and in the universe in general. And we talk about, in general, what is the property of dark matter and how we found the evidence. And it's like, this is one of the good evidence. When the two clusters colliding each other and the matter is interacting each other more strongly than dark matter, so it kind of has slowed down at the collision, so it gathers together at the middle. When the dark matter is passing by, so it has a separate distribution from the matter, so it gives nice evidence of the dark matter distribution. And we also talk about what is the connection of crossing rate and dark matter. Because one of the signatures of dark matter can actually show up in the flux of crossing rate antiparticle, like positron and the antiproton. So by looking at the crossing rate, they can get the signature of dark matter in that way. So that was the connection that we talked in the last lecture. And the other field of physics that I mentioned was neutrino physics. So neutrino is one of the fundamental particles, and it's really, really interacting, not really interacting with the matter at all. So the low interaction rate with the matter gives them freedom to travel from wherever it created to the Earth. So the neutrino data can give us direct evidence of the crossing rate, especially protons interaction, because crossing rate is charged particle, so it will be bent inside the magnetic field, so we cannot point to its source. So we can use gamma ray for that kind of to bend that kind of interaction thing, because gamma ray can create it because the crossing ray interacting with the matter in the galaxy, and they can travel without the bending inside the magnetic field. The problem with the gamma ray though is that we cannot really recognize the difference. Well, there's few ways that we can do, but it's really hard to recognize the original gamma ray. It can come from the electron, and it can come from the photon. And up to now, we found more evidence of gamma ray emitted by electron, because electron has more channel to create gamma rays. But neutrino is created by interaction of photon. So if we measure something neutrino, some neutrino coming from the interaction ray from the supernova, that will give us direct information of proton's acceleration in the source. So that is the connection with the neutrino physics and constant rate. And also because neutrino is not interacting that much with the matter, so they need to be a really gigantic detector. So for example, in here we are seeing ice cube, like 2.4 kilometers deep down in the ice, and they are using this entire area in the Antarctica South Pole to measure the neutrino shower. And because of this large area of their detector, they can actually measure some air shower coming from the crossing rate and do gain a lot of statistics, a lot of large chunk of data, and which can give an interesting study on the crossing rate. And for example, one of them are anisotropy of galactic crossing rate. We always assume that galactic crossing rate is isotropic, and it does, but they found like less than 0.1% of anisotropy is existing in the galactic crossing rate. So there is some kind of interconnection between the neutrino physics in general, and also because of the detection way. So that was kind of brief summary. And this lecture, in our last lecture in Causing Wave Physics related thing, I wanted to first of all summarize about our last 8 lectures, so history of Causing Wave, property of Causing Wave, and connection between Causing Wave and other fields of physics. Already I kind of covered that one, so maybe I will pass that one very fast. So to summarize and refresh our memory from 1 week of vacation, which I had, this I enjoyed for sure. And then I will talk about the new measurement, what is the new thing and what is the old thing. So that I will try to cover, and then we will see about the current and near future experiment in the Causing Wave. Okay, so history of Causing Wave, I think maybe it's better to see the your handout. By the way, there's 2 typos in my handout. I think in the, there was a, I think in the last page I said positron, I was meant to say positron, then I say something like position instead of, yeah, here. Somewhere. I will try, when I upload my handout in the webpage, I will try to fix all that with the typo. So just be careful when you see position, you need to consider whether it's actually position or positron. Okay. So, Causing Wave has been discovered by Dieter Hess in a balloon experiment in 1912, and next year is centennium. So today we are here, 2011, and 2012 will be exactly 100 years from the discovery of Causing Wave. And a lot of things happened during these 99 years of Causing Wave. And here I just try to point out just important thing. Well, I thought it's important thing. But again, you can imagine there's a lot of activity happening, especially in the recent era. So just going from the past to the present, so Dieter Hess found the Causing Wave in 1912, but it was named by as a Causing Wave as we call right now around 1932. So actually what I try to plot in here is number of paper or proceeding that I can find in the searching engine which containing Causing Wave in title. And x-axis is the year, which is kind of matching with all years. So I tried to find in 10-year period how many paper a day are there. And also, I just realized that I cannot find any paper in this period because people does not use Causing Wave at that time. They used like strange rays from maybe Causing Wave or origin or ionization radiation or something like that. They just didn't use Causing Wave as we casually use right now. So looking at the history was fairly interesting that way. So there's 0 paper containing Causing Wave at that time. And Millikan coined in the name of Causing Wave at around, in the textbook I found is 1932, but I found one paper written by him in 1928, and he was already using Causing Wave in title. So it was kind of a mixture, so I kind of put in here. So there's like 10 paper containing Causing Wave. Not because there's just 10 paper related with the Causing Wave, but at that time people still use, some people use Causing Wave, some people use other names and things like that. So it's kind of a mixture period. And from here until 1950s, Causing Wave has been used for the discovery of particles because we didn't have accelerator at that time. So a lot of new particles has been discovered by using Causing Wave, like positrons, muons, and tanyons, and those kind of particles are discovered by looking at the bubble chamber or cloud chamber and looking at the trace of Causing Wave interacting with the matter. And a lot of discovery, I mean, I'm quite sure that if I write down all the Nobel Prize and discovery done related to Causing Wave, it would be like the long entire period in here and also in here. And around here, the Causing Wave kind of saved by the particle physics in a way because particle physics started to use their accelerator. And, well, around 1, 10, 12, 13, 14, 15, so it's about 50 years. And then the around here, they discovered the Causing Wave micro background, and then there is a prediction that there will not be any higher energy than 10 to the 20 electron volts because of interaction with that. So that happened in here. And I mean, a lot of things is missing in this plot, but yeah. And like, for example, it was interesting for me that they found the most Causing Wave are proton with some helium and a small fraction of heavy nuclei at around 1950. 48 or so. So it took them for like 30 years to find out the major source or major composition of cosmic rays, proton. But from here to here, we developed quite a lot of experiments, and we now know much more about the cosmic rays. We know better about the composition, energy dependence, and everything. So I will talk about that later here. And interesting in here is you can, so this is log plot, so it's 10 year, 100-ish, but around 1952, it jumped into like 500, and then it jumped in 1,000 in 1962, and after that, it kind of maintained like 5,000 or 6,000 the paper for 10 years related with the cosmic ray. Again, here, I just briefly find with the title with the cosmic ray, so if the paper title is other than cosmic ray, but containing cosmic ray, it will not be counted here.
Is that number of papers in 10 years that you okay, so that's, okay.
Yeah, I kind of hope that it's much more dramatic, like increasing like that. It was not enough. All right, so general summary of what we talked in the last eight lectures. So first of all, definition of a cosmic ray is charged particle originating outer space that reach the Earth is the kind of general definition of cosmic ray, and this is a famous plot that I showed like two more times during the lecture. So it is flux of cosmic ray. So cosmic ray is really covering quite a lot of energy range from like 10 to the 8 electron volt up to 10 to the 20 electron volt. So it's really, really wide energy range that this particle coming from outside the Earth is covering. And as you can see, it's really, really smooth, and it's really hard to actually see in this plot, but there's this slope is changing briefly and in large quantity in 2 points at least. Now people are debating there's no more than 2 points where the slope is changing. But generally, I'm just covering the general picture and postpone the surprising later part. Generally, we believe that there's 2 points where the slope of this flux is changing. So one point we call as knee and the other point we call as ankle. And also the other thing that you need to, well, you already heard this like a lot of time, but just to just accentuate what is over it. Because it's kind of interesting factor to see how rapidly this flux changes. So at around 10 to the 10 electron volt, there would be one particle per square meter per second. So if you have a square meter detector, then there would be one particle you can measure in per second. But its energy goes higher and higher, so 10 to the 15 electron volt. Now you have like one, if you have the same size of detector, then now you need to wait 1 year to take one particle detection. And it goes harder and harder, and it, at this energy, 10 to the 18 electron volt ankle energy range, you need to have a 1 square kilometer detector and then wait 1 year, then you will measure one particle. So the flux is really, really decreasing rapidly with the energy goes higher and higher. So that's why it becomes much harder to study about the higher energy of cosmic ray. And that's also why we are focusing more on the higher energy cosmic ray nowadays. So that was the flux part of the cosmic ray. And then the composition, we talk about this. And the composition, we know that it is meant to be changed with energy. But as because of this flux, low flux in high energy, it's still ongoing project. And so in here, I just noted, just plotted the cosmic ray composition at 1 GeV, which is around here. So we take a lot of particles coming in 1 second. So 85% of cosmic ray is proton, and 12% is helium, and 2% is electron. But electron will decrease much rapidly, so it will become less, much less than 1% at like 10 to the 12 electron. But at here is like percent, and 1% is heavy element. Heavy element include heavier than helium. So every element that you can think of, like carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, boron, beryllium, and up to much heavier iron, or made much heavier than iron. Everything is included in this 1% in 1 GeV. So that's composition. And direction, we kind of generally think that the galactic cosmic ray, which is here, so we kind of generally assume the galactic cosmic ray, so this part of low energy cosmic ray is coming from our galaxy, and the highest energy of cosmic ray in this part, we kind of generally think is coming from the extra galactic, so outside our galaxy, just because this bending radius of this high energy passing ray is really, really large. So our galaxy and then our known galactic magnetic field just cannot contain those because the radius is too bigger than the or the similar size of our galaxy. So that's why we think that the highest part of cosmic ray may come from the outside our galaxy, and its dark side is coming from our galaxy, and that's more likely expected to be isotropic. Of course, I mentioned that now we know that it's slightly anisotropic in less than 0.1% level. And extra galactic cosmic ray, because it's not really banding that much, we kind of expect that there will be anisotropic, and we may actually use the directional information and point to the source. So just to point a little bit deeper each item, so flux. So if you look at the galactic cosmic ray, we talk about the acceleration, how cosmic ray can gain their energy in this really, really up to high energy. And for the galactic cosmic ray, we talk that supernova remnant is maybe a good accelerator for accelerating the cosmic ray in this high energy, because there are a lot of them, not a lot of them, but enough of them to explain the continuous flux of cosmic ray that we are measuring at Earth right now. And if that is the case, we can actually estimate how much energy the cosmic rays can gain by supernova remnant. And according to theory, they are expecting the maximum, there is maximum limitation the cosmic ray can gain or accelerating the supernova remnant. And that is related with the G value of the cosmic ray. So proton can go like 10 to the 14 energy, at 14 electron volt at maximum in a supernova remnant, when the helium can go twice higher than the proton, and the ion can much heavier, reach to the higher energy than proton. So if that is the case, you can imagine that if you can measure the elementary spectrum, then you will see this kind of banding. Because, so for example, proton can reach to higher energy but at certain energy, you will kind of start to be decreasing because it hits the maximum energy that can be created in the supernova, so it will be decreasing like that. And helium can reach a little bit higher than that because they can gain more energy in the supernova remnant. So you would expect that this kind of banding difference depends on the charge of each element. So that kind of thing can gain together, and maybe if you can add all of them, then maybe you can make this shape, which may be why we have a need in that location. It kind of matches with our idea, because supernova remnant can explain the flux very well. So that's one of the theory, and there's experiment which try to measure this individual spectrum of the cosmic ray individual element to see whether this is really the case or not. So that was also mentioned during the lecture. I may not deep too much because I think you can find in the webpage and try to read through and refresh your memory. And if you go to the highest energy in the flux, we kind of expect it because interaction between the ultra high energy cosmic ray with cosmic microwave background, there will be some kind of maximum energy that we can measure in the Earth. So you would expect there will be some kind of flux suppression at the highest energy of cosmic ray. So if you look at around here, the UZ experiment, say that they are seeing the flux separation, so that was one of the features that we talk about more so in the flux. And about the overhead wall, I should have you spectrum there. Okay. And the composition is again the comparison between solar system abundance and galactic cosmic ray abundance. We talk about there's a similarity and difference in the abundance. So similarity, we talk about why they are need to be similar, like there's more even number than odd number, and because of binding energy, and also the same reason, because of the same reason, we are seeing much more lighter element compared to heavy element, like there's more ion and some ion compared to heavier than that. So we talk about that, and then we also talk about the differences in the solar abundance and the galactic cosmic ray abundance. So here we have much more in light element and then some ion in the galactic cosmic ray compared to solar system abundance. And part of the reason why is because the cosmic ray need to travel from its original site to the Earth, and during this traveling, they are making a lot of matter inside our galaxy, and that make an interaction, and some of them will be destroyed, and some of them will be become a light element. For example, carbon can destroy and become a boron, and then we are measuring, we can measure boron in that way. So that's why we are seeing much boron and then beryllium in the cosmic rays and the solar system abundance. So we can actually measure the secondary and the primary. So primary is the cosmic ray coming from the original site, and secondary is cosmic ray created because of this interaction during their travel. So by measuring those kind of quantities, we can actually estimate how long the cosmic ray is staying in our galaxy and how many interactions or how many matters are there during their trip. So that can be measured in the Earth. And we can compare the mostly secondary, like boron, we know that it's 100% secondary. So by comparing the primary and secondary, we can estimate those kind of stuff and try to make our propagation theory correct by fitting them with the real data. And if we can do that, what we can also do is by looking at the measurement that done in the Earth, and we can just remove this part based on our theory and then try to estimate what is the original amount of cosmic ray in the source, and we do the comparison to see whether it's actually similar with solar abundance or not. And recent measurement actually suggests that it seems like if we remove this part in the cosmic ray that we are measuring and compare the original amount of cosmic ray at source with solar abundance, actually it seems like you need a little bit heavier star to create to explain the amount of cosmic ray at source that we are estimating. So one of the measurements suggests that we need at least 20% of a heavy star remnant or material coming from the heavy star and 80% of interstellar medium to explain what we are measuring. So that's some of the things that we can also do with the cosmic ray and the property of cosmic ray related with composition. And then directional cosmic ray, I divide by two, because one large chunk of cosmic ray, the galactic cosmic ray part, we just cannot measure the direction or arrival direction, because even if you see one cosmic ray coming in this direction, it does not mean it comes in that direction, because the magnetic field is already bending too much around. We almost use the term diffusion because it's just scattering too much around the magnetic field. And also we talk about how many magnetic field is surrounding us. The Earth's magnetic field and the solar system has magnetic field. And also we talk about the galactic magnetic field. So all this magnetic field is preventing cosmic ray to move straightly. So even if you measure one direction in one way, it doesn't mean that it comes from that direction. So we don't have directional information for the galactic cosmic ray, most of the part. But the new measurement done in a large area detector suggests that actually there's about 0.1% of anisotropy, and it has a large kind of structure, but also kind of small structure. So it is really ongoing project to understand why we are seeing anisotropy in this larger scale thing. But generally it's isotropy. You can just assume that this is really, really small amount of anisotropy. And the extra galactic cosmic ray, really, really high energy in here, because they are so large energy, it is really hard to bend them with the galactic magnetic field or extra galactic magnetic field. So by looking at the arrival direction actually may give us some kind of idea about where it actually came from. So OZE experiment is looking at that arrival direction and try to match with the possible accelerator of a high energy cosmic ray. Here it is plotted with their, so this black dot is their point, so that their measurement. And they are trying to match whether it matches more with the active galactic nuclei, which is one of possible accelerator to give the high energy of cosmic ray or not. So that's also ongoing study, and then we can actually use directional information for high energy cosmic ray. So that was a part of that. And this part we already covered, so let's just briefly, I will just briefly mention it. Okay, still have 5 minutes, okay. So from the start, there is an original site of cosmic ray, and somehow it is accelerating a high energy, and it kind of travels around the galaxy and then reaches to the Earth. So in here, I try to divide again the galactic cosmic ray and extra galactic cosmic ray. sample, we still need to do more measurement to say, to see whether it's actually true and it can explain everything that we are measuring. But according to one or two experiments at least, they suggest that original passing rate is mixture of material from heavy stars and interstellar medium. Like 20% of it is the heavy star medium, material from the heavy star, and 80% of interstellar medium. And we did that by looking at the composition at the source by retracing all these traveling backwards. So we subtract the amount of particle coming from the propagation and try to estimate looking at the composition. And that was the conclusion we got. And as acceleration, we know that we kind of estimate that it can be accelerated in the supernova rather than the shock wave. Fermi was creating the theory of the particle gain their energy by scattering around the moving magnetic cloud. And then later, there was another theory which is developing more sophisticated way to explain how charged particle can gain their energy by scattering around the shock wave. And we know that supernova can generate, provide that kind of shock wave. So acceleration can be happening in the supernova remnant. And we also can prove that by looking at the elementary spectra of passing away. So that's ongoing project. We will see whether that is the case or not. And the propagation, we know that there's a lot of things happening in the propagation. First of all, it will be bending inside the magnetic field multiple times, and it will be destroyed and can be changed into much lighter element. Carbon can be boron, or iron can be much lighter than ion. So that kind of thing can happen. And if it is destroyed in an unstable stage, then it can decay from there. And also it will lose its energy because of material between whatever energy, whatever original accelerator site will be causing way to the Earth. So, and then also convection and then reacceleration can happen during the propagation. And we can look at the secondary to primary ratio in a cosmic ray measurement to estimate and then try to make a theory or models to pin out all the propagation. And all these pictures should match with all our knowledge about our galaxy and magnetic field and material in the galaxy. And for the extragalactic cosmic ray, a lot of things is unknown because there's just few of them, so we really need to study more deeply. But we kind of think that maybe AGN can accelerate them at highest energy, so which can measure by Earth. And the reason we kind of assume that maybe this material around the accelerator proton dominant or some other thing, but there's some kind of assumption. There's a lot of question mark here. And propagation, we know that the highest energy of cosmic ray can be pointed to the source site, as we just said. And all of this information can be gained by looking at the composition and the measurement of arrival direction and the correlation with possible sources. So that was like general summary of what we talked during last 8 lectures. And we talked also about the correlation, connecting between cosmic ray and the gamma rays. So gamma, you can actually look at the gamma ray from the supernova remnant, which this is one of the examples, the Tycho measurement done by Veritas. And this gamma ray, TV gamma ray, is created by interaction with the molecular cloud and the cosmic ray. So you can actually, we actually found that at least one or two or multiple supernova remnants, which actually give us the gamma ray, which is created by cosmic ray. So it's kind of giving more information in this accelerator side. So by looking at the gamma ray, we now know that there is existing high energy cosmic ray coming from the supernova remnant side. So gamma ray experiment is giving us another information about the accelerator in that way. And also about the propagation, by looking at the diffusive gamma ray, which is created between the material in the galaxy and the interaction with that cosmic ray, and that is creating gamma ray. We are looking at this galactic plane shining in the gamma ray. So they can also help the propagation, because we know, if we know the material distribution in the galaxy, then we can estimate whether that fits in our model of propagation of cosmic ray or not, because this is coming from the interaction of cosmic ray with the material in the galaxy. And the neutrino astron physics that we talk about, because neutrino can come from the supernova remnant, and because it is not interacting that much with the material, so if we can measure this from the supernova remnant, we will be able to have a hint of cosmic rays existing of high-energy crossing rays in the supernova remnant. And also neutrino can come from the interaction of highest energy of crossing ray with the crossing ray background. So by measuring this property of neutrino coming in this interaction, that can also give us a clue about the extragalactic crossing ray. And well, if there is any kind of signature that we can find in dark matter, it can be found by excess of secondary antiparticles. So it could be measured some more excess in the positron, for example, and if it cannot be explained by propagation, then maybe there is a chance that it actually came from the dark matter. So that was summary of our 8 lectures up to now. So from here, we will talk about the new measurement in the risk. So there has been quite a lot. I mean, we continuously build the experiment and then continuously analyze our data and try to understand what's going on in the cosmic ray. In here, I try to pick up the interesting new measurement or famous new measurements done in this field in the recent era. So there's a lot of agreeing with the conventional models. The conventional model means there's nothing special. We kind of can estimate, we kind of develop our model. So there's a data which nicely matches with our expectation, which is great, because that means we are not that wrong. So for example, we know that there is a measurement done by Tracer that is following experiment, actually, University of Chicago. Like, that's kind of interesting model experiment because it's just built by only by University of Chicago, so it's very, very interesting model experiment. Anyway, so they published the data from oxygen to ion spectrum, and here is the spectrum. So you can see they are kind of generally following the power law, one power law, single power law. So it's generally following the smooth power law distribution as we talk. So they didn't really reach to the knee point to see the flux change yet because again, it's really few of them. But up till there, it looks like it's following the smooth one line of slope that we mentioned. So that was agreeing with the conventional model. And Pamela in 2010, the main measured the ratio of proton to antiproton to see. And then this is their measurement. It seems like it's following very well. Suggesting that all the antiproton that they measure is coming from the propagation, so some kind of interaction generate the antiproton, and then this can be explained by interaction with the cosmic ray and matter. So that's kind of matching with our conventional model, saying that the antiproton is coming from the only secondary origin. So that is kind of agreeing with the existing model in a way. The model itself is not just one model, so that's why you are seeing this width in this band. But again, there's no surprise there. And we also see the suppression of quantum wave in the highest energy as we expected. And also we are seeing an isotropic of highest energy of quantum wave as we kind of also expected to see. So these are kind of really nice agreement with the measurement with the conventional model. But again, as light goes, there is not only agreement but also disagreement. So there has been quite a lot of surprises. One of the surprises, I already covered this in the previous lecture because it was way too interesting to test the So one of the things is we actually found out that there is an anisotropic or galactic crossing ray, at least in the 10 TeV it was measured. So there is like small anisotropic, which we didn't really expect it well. And then the ultra high energy crossing ray, we kind of assume that because if it is coming from extragalactic and the composition of extragalactics or around that kind of AGN or things like that, we kind of naively assume that it may be proton dominant because galactic cosmic ray is proton dominant. Almost 85% of galactic cosmic ray are proton, so we generally or naturally assume that this may be proton dominant even in the highest energy cosmic ray coming from the extragalactic origin. But surprisingly, it seems like it is more like heavier element. So in here, again, these people are looking at the air shower, the interaction of cosmic ray with air, to estimate what is the composition. So they cannot say whether this is coming from the proton or ion. So that's why we have both line here. So in here, this is group of line where if all the particles that they are measuring is 100% of proton, and these lines are if all the particles they are measuring is 100% iron. So you can see it is kind of going to iron as energy goes higher. So it seems like there's more heavy element inside the ultra high energy cosmic ray. So that was kind of surprising. Now people are trying to study what kind of thing can make that happen. So there's a lot of theory related with that. So, but I will pass the theory part. And there was another surprise, excess of positron. So this is the one plotted here. So Pamela measured the positron. In 2009, they published their positron measurement. So this red line in here is if, like antiproton, if all the positron that we are measuring is coming from the interaction of cosmic ray with matter by their travel, if 100% of positron is like that, it should follow this line. But Pamela measurement showed that actually it is increasing, not following this line. So there has been a lot of like estimation to say, well, maybe this is coming from the dark matter, or maybe it's coming from the other positron source like cursor, or maybe our understanding of our propagation theory is wrong, but still it's kind of debatable and still a lot of people is working on that. Actually, it was very interesting because after this paper, there has been like hundreds of theoretical physicists' papers to explain their own model to explain why it should be in that way. But it's still an ongoing project. And so AMS has been launched in recent times, so they are doing the same measurements. So hopefully, either they will agree, they will not agree. It will be very interesting to see the new measurement. But this has been a surprise, interesting surprise. And also, this is chain of interesting surprise for at least for me, because now I'm working on electron measurement. So what happened was there's ATIC, which is balloon experiment. In 2008, they published their paper in Science, which shows really interesting picture here. So this is electron spectrum, and this black line is the conventional model, the prediction of conventional model. But they show this interesting picture here. And peak is also always interesting because there should be some really particular physics involved if there is a peak. So a lot of dark matter physics was really love this plot and tried to explain this with dark matter. But, and then there was following experiment, following papers, so 2008 and 2009, we had two other papers. One was done by Hess, which is gamma ray physics, and they showed the kind of these lines. Red dot and the blue dot is their measurement, and they said, maybe we don't really see that peak. So this is the peak done seen by ATIC. So there has been some kind of disagreement with ATIC, and they reached to the electron up to here, and they also show something like maybe it is increasing, but we're not sure, kind of bump at the end of their spectra. So that's kind of also interesting. In the Fermi, they measure their spectrum in electron, and this is their measurement. And again, this is anti-bomb. So some people say that, well, maybe it's the same. They're just seeing a little bit smaller bomb than us because their detector is different from us. And there's a lot of debate. It's kind of really exciting and interesting. At least one clear part in here is a lot of data is showing something that we didn't expect it to see. So these are really new excitement in this field. And because, for example, this blue line in here is conventional model. So some people say that, well, they don't have a really, really particular peak like ATIC, but they still seems to be disagreeing with the conventional model, and it seems like there's some excess in both excess in here. And the most recent measurement of electron is done by Pamela again in 2011. So it actually is from the paper published like a month ago. And this is their measurement. And it's not really clear to see here, but they said that this can be either explained by conventional model, or they still have some space to add some more excess in the electron. So it's still need to see what will be the conclusion. So it's kind of interesting to see all these kind of results, surprises. seems like they are kind of debating for the more access than conventional model. But then what is the origin of that access? Is it dark matter, or is it coming from other source in electron, or is it just our conventional propagation model is not good enough to explain this flux? There's still a lot of questions there, and we are studying to find out which answer is right one to fit every piece in one picture. So that was the surprise. And this is the last item in this list of surprise. Another surprise was the flux change point. So we kind of expected the cosmic wave flux will just follow smoothly until it reached to the knee point. In that knee point, which may be happening because of maximum energy mutation in the cosmic wave acceleration in supernova, right? And so there's one slope change, but until then, we will have smooth line there. So if I have a line here to keep under the better loop on that, so maybe everything is fitting in this one line until the knee point. That was conventional model. But recent measurement done by Cream experiment and the Pamela experiment seems to say no about that conventional model. So again, if that is following this one single line, it should follow this line, this flat line. So then it multiplied by some energy, so that's why you are seeing flat line here. So if every measurement is following and aligned nicely with this one single line, then all the measurement points should be lining in this nice flat line. But according to Cream, at least they are seeing much more excess for a change of slope at some point, much before the knee. So if the prediction of maximum acceleration energy for the supernova is correct, usually to explain the knee, this is the point where you would see the flux change. So you would expect to have a protonate helium or any other element following this nice flat line until some moment around here. And from here, maybe they will change their flux into other value than flat line. But instead of that, they kind of see much earlier flux change in a lower energy, not only for proton and helium, but even a heavy element. So it's kind of a new surprise. So it seems like there's another kink before the around this reason, and that was paper in 2010 and 11, and then recently Pamela also show their proton and helium flux in here. It seems this is not flat line just because they use different value here. So in here they also show that some kind of change of the flux in there. This is a little bit hard to see in here, but again, if you change the flux, it actually increasing like cream does, cream sleep. So that's kind of interesting. So why this happens, and that is also ongoing study, the issue of ongoing study, but it's definitely surprising new measurement result. So that's kind of new measurement that I selected in here. So it has been like 99 years since we discovered the cosmic ray. So you may assume, actually I kind of may assume up to now that everything is following the picture that we kind of studied up to now, but still there's a lot of new surprise in the field. And that's why we need more measurement and more precise measurement with more data. So these are the list of the current and near future experiment. There's maybe some more experiment which is not covered here because I just picked up the list of the experiment I know. So there's a satellite experiment which is launched in the space. The merit of satellite experiment is there's no air in the space. So meaning that there will be no less material, so you can actually measure the cosmic ray coming directly from the galaxy, not from the galaxy, but before the interaction of cosmic ray with the air, because then you can estimate much clearer information about the cosmic ray. So we already have a common law, which has been measured the cosmic ray for like more than 5 years or so. And the AMS just joined this list of experiments like very recently, like 3 days or how long ago? I don't know, now it's like 2 weeks ago. And apparently it was launched successfully and then mounted successfully in the International Space Station, and everything seems to be working very well, so maybe we will be able to expect to see some new result from AMS-02, either agreeing or disagreeing with Pamela result. Any case will be interesting in the near future, in like 1 or 2 years from now on. So that would be interesting to see. And the balloon experiment, there's a several balloon experiment. Balloon experiment is usually go to the Antarctica and using this large balloon. It doesn't really look large, but if you see human being is laid out in here, and after it goes to a certain altitude, it kind of inflated. So the size of this balloon become a size of a football stadium. So it's really, really large balloon. So the good part of the balloon experiment is that the lifetime of the experiment is really short. You can actually build the instrument and then fly the instrument in like 3 years. So the life cycle of balloon is like 3 years to 5 years to finish their analysis. So we can quickly measure things and estimate things, and if we can develop more about our detector, then we can add more stuff in there. So that's kind of merit compared to space experiment, and also it's much cheaper than satellite experiment. So that's good part about the balloon experiment. Bad part is we still have air above us, so we go to up to 40 kilometers above the sea level, but still we have 1% of air left us, so there would be some material above us, meaning that some of the cotton weight that we are measuring in the balloon is already after the interacting with air, so that kind of make it a little bit more harder than the space experiment. Because, for example, even if you measure the positron, some amount of positron that you are measuring is actually coming from the interaction of cosmic wave with air. So if you want to estimate positron flux in the cosmic wave, then you need to remove that part of the interaction. So that's just to make it a little bit more, your life a little bit more complicated. But, well, so there's ANITA. We talked about ANITA last lecture. It's a neutrino experiment to try to measure the neutrino by looking at the signal refracting from the ice to see the hint of interaction with the ultra high energy cosmic wave with the cosmic wave background, cosmic microwave background. And the cream is just to see that their recent result. These two are from the cream experiment. So that's very long ongoing balloon experiment. Their goal is trying to measure the elemental spectrum to explain the nihilism, whether we are seeing that kind of bending the nihil or not. And CREST is the experiment that I'm working on, and we are trying to measure the energy, the electron in the really, really high energy, 10 to the 12 electron volt is the one that we want to measure. So that's one experiment. And Super Tiger, we also talk about Tiger measurement like two lectures ago when we talk about the composition of cosmic ray. So they are measuring ultra heavy nuclei of cosmic ray, part of cosmic ray. And we already have the research from the Tiger experiment. Super Tiger is actually twice bigger than Tiger. That's why they named it Super Tiger. And also, budget-wise, you need to give a better and shiny name for funding. So Super sounds very nice, right? So they are ongoing balloon experiment as well. And we also have a ground experiment. One, we got a lot of data from Pierre Ozier Observatory. All the ultra-high-energy cosmic ray data that I show you up to now is mostly coming from the Pierre Ozier Observatory. This is the map of Argentina and the area of their detector. So all this red dot is their detector. So their detector actually covers 3,000 kilometers square area in Argentina. So they are really, really large area detector. And the telescope array is also now under construction, I think, and then kind of saying they're, both of them are aiming to measure ultra high energy cosmic ray to see the composition and the flux of ultra high energy cosmic ray and the direction and correction of them. So I just added one slide on CREST because I'm working on that. So CREST stands for the cosmic ray electron synchrotron telescope, and we are trying to measure the electron as it says in here. So this is a known electron spectra, and it has kind of see this dropping here. It is dropping in here because electron loses its energy much faster than the other component of cosmic ray, like proton or helium. And CREST is trying to measure the electron above several TeV, so actually 5 TeV-ish is the when our efficiency is catching up. So this is energy reason that we want to measure. And it's really, really hard because to really feel them, we kind of expect there will be 2 electrons above this energy per day. So So it's a very low flux. And why it is interesting is because we think that we can see the local distribution of electron source in this energy. For example, Gala, well, there's a lot of models, but according to one model, we may be able to, there may be some bump because of the nearby supernova remnant like Gala, so we may be able to see those. Or if we cannot see those, that means that the propagation theory or this model need to be fixed. So in any case, it would be interesting. Well, it would be much interesting if there's something that we are seeing. But, so that is the crash, so we designed to measure the multi-TV region to see the nearby cosmic ray accelerator by looking at the electron. So why it is interesting, especially in CREST, I think, is because we are not measuring the electron by itself. It's really hard to measure electron by itself because it's really, really few of them. So what we do is we try to measure the synchrotron coming from the electron. So what happens is when high-energy electron come to the Earth and bend inside of the geomagnetic field, it can emit the synchrotron. And we know the geomagnetic field strength, so we can estimate what is the energy of this synchrotron radiation. And that energy of synchrotron radiation is correlated with the energy of electron. And by measuring this synchrotron radiation, we can estimate what is the electron energy. And why you would ask, like, why are you doing the, such a complicated job? Not why are you not just measuring the electron? The reason why is because even if the electron is just one, it can emit multiple synchrotron radiation. So that way we can actually increase our effective area. So even if our detector is 2 meter by 2 meter, we can actually act like by estimating all this intervention, we can actually estimate our detector such like our detector is larger than 2 meter by 2 meter. So actually it can be estimated as like 10 times or 100 times larger than our actual detector size, because you don't really need to measure the electron, one electron. We can just measure multiple synchrotron to catch the signature from the electron. So that's why this is interesting. I think it's kind of a neat idea to use geomagnetic field for doing that. Of course, it's a really hard experiment because, again, we have 2 electrons per day. So like after 30 days of our flight, you crossing the finger, because we have flight in Antarctica in 2011 this year. And the flight in Antarctica is really dependent on a lot. Your flight can as short as 10 days, or it can be long, like 30 days. The record longest is 42 days or so. So even in, you know, even 40 days, you have 80 electrons. So it's kind of hard. And that's the max optimized case, because it can be finished in 10 days. In that case, we would have 20 electrons. And I will not tell how many background that I estimate, because it's a huge number. So anyway, we will see what's going on. So actually, it's ongoing. And I just went to Indiana 2 weeks ago and lost just 2 days ago, too. So I'm traveling quite a lot. And Indiana University is the main PI is in Indiana University. And the University of Chicago joined in this experiment for a long time. Me, Scott Wakely, who was also a lecturer in a Compton lecture, and Dietrich Mueller is co-leading in this collaboration. And this is our current really fresh picture from the instrument taken 2 days ago. So it's fairly large. Actually, it's I think slightly taller than my size. They use Nahi unit to estimate the length of my detector, because I'm kind of really nice length to show how big this one is. So this height is 1 Nahi unit, so it's slightly taller than me. Quite a lot about the cosmic ray. I mean, thinking thing about the beginning part, when like 20 years people were wondering whether cosmic ray is actually particle or electromagnetic radiation. And from that era, now we actually know that what is the composition and what is energy distribution. Even we reach to the highest energy of cosmic ray and actually point to the sun direction of the highest energy of cosmic ray. So we learned really, really a lot about the cosmic ray. We now kind of generally know how long they stay in our galaxy before traveling to the Earth and everything like that. But as I just showed, the list of surprises in recent measurement, it just does not cease to surprise us. There's still a lot of surprises in recent measurement, and there's still a lot of mystery to solve. Like, for example, what is the origin of cosmic ray? Still, we still have some kind of clue, but that need to be reconfirmed by multiple ways to check if that is actually the case or whether it's a single case or not, and how they travel and things like that. So there are still a lot of things that we need to solve. And hopefully this excitement, like new measurement, which agrees with our model, either it agrees with our model or not agree with our model, either case is really exciting to see. So hopefully that will continue as our understanding of physics increases. For example, because it's not only cosmic ray, it's just understanding cosmic ray just requires a lot of information from other fields. For example, we need to understand the interaction processes of cosmic ray from low energy until really, really high energy. And that kind of give us, now the particle physicist is giving us nice feedback about what is interaction of cosmic ray at really, really high energy would look like. So that need to be added to hold all the picture together. And also we need to understand our universe, what is the magnetic field, what is the structure of that, is it like a local, what would be the effect of cosmic rays traveling or re-acceleration if there's a localized magnetic field and that sort of stuff. And so we need to understand as our understanding of our universe increases, the picture of cosmic ray will be defined more accurately or changes completely from our conventional model. And also we need to understand the astronomical processes like supernova remnant, what is the efficiency of cosmic ray accelerating in the supernova remnant, or is there any other processes in the astronomical object which can accelerate cosmic ray in high energy. Well, things like that will be really, really needed to complete our picture in the cosmic ray. To do that, we do need to do a lot of cosmic ray measurements, measuring the cosmic ray. But not only for the cosmic ray measurement, we can also get some hints from the gamma ray measurement as we talk about, and also other wavelength measurements like radio wave, visual light wave, everything really helpful. And also neutrino measurement and a lot of different things that I didn't mention during the lecture. Anything can help. For example, you would imagine what would be the connection between cosmic ray and material science, but it would be helpful because to measure our things, we really need a detector, and knowing about the material would be helpful to develop the better detector. So every physics is helpful to even complete the picture in our picture in cosmic ray. And again, every pieces of all this information need to be nicely matching up to explain everything, not only for the cosmic ray, but our understanding of the galaxy and universe and everything need to be perfectly matching. So hopefully we will, in the near future, we see better jigsaw puzzle result from this picture of cosmic ray. Thank you very much for your